want to very quickly give the context in which the lecture is being held. At CEPT, we are trying to, we want to set up this new center for urban land policy. Urban land policy is extremely important because cities are important to economic growth, and the supply of land for growth is important for cities. Supply of land requires a lot of government intervention, or has government intervention, but requires rights of government intervention. And research in that area is extremely important. So we're setting up this center because we think that urban land policy is very important and work needs to be done in this area. Just to put it in context, CEPT can actually four or five areas in which we are doing lots of very interesting work. One is the Center for Urban Transport. That's doing lots of interesting work. That's led to the setting up of the BRTS and various other such initiatives. And there's a Center for Urban Equity that's looking at equity issues, and that's a group of people who's doing interesting work there. There's another one that is doing work on crafts. That's, I think, sort of cutting edge work on crafts is being done there. There's another one on energy, and that group of people is doing really important and interesting work on buildings and energy. And now we hope that there will be a lot of work done on urban land issues. It's important for any university to focus on a few areas. You cannot do everything. And so it's important to identify the key areas and set up groups of people who will continue doing work on that area for a period of time. Then you want to set up some sort of a center. You need somebody who has a sense of where things, what the important questions are, what's the work that needs to be done, and how we need to move ahead to sort of give it some sort of direction. I think we're very fortunate in having Mr. Patak, DJ Patak, who many of you know quite well, who has agreed to direct the center. From amongst our faculty members, Utul Sharma is going to be the coordinator of the center and direct the work there. I'm not going to take up too much time because I know we're all here. Maybe you can listen to Professor Bertaud, who has done vast amounts of work in urban land issue. He has done work globally and has done work that has lots of practical relevance. And if I were to give a mandate to the center, I would say that this center do lots of work of the sort that Professor Bertaud has done up to now. That should be the sort of guiding that work and his approach and his attitude is what should guide all the work that is done at the center. So with that, let me stop, ask Mr. Patak to say a few words, and then we can actually listen to Professor Bertaud.
Thank you, Vivek. I will be very brief because I don't want to come in between Alain's lecture before which you have covered. This center is a very topical issue because as the Indian urbanization and economic growth catches up, urbanization and of course related to land, because increasingly it's going to be an urban land market which is going to define how the cities are going to be. Planning so far has been largely concentrating on land use and how that should be controlled. And we have seen the result of that. The isolation from the market has shown that plans are not implemented and something else happens. And everybody knows what those results are. So this center will essentially focus on three broad areas, because one has to make a beginning. That does not mean other issues are excluded. First is looking at land and real estate market and their relationship with land. And within that, the issues are how you increase supply of land for urban growth. there are issues about how do you get land for public purposes, be that road or other infrastructure. How do you ensure that land is available across the income scales for people to pursue their livelihood as well as their housing? And the third issue is how do you look at land as a fiscal resource? Because you will have to raise resources out of land development and not depend on the external funding for those purposes. Because what you do by way of infrastructure, plans, etc., reflects in the increased land values and how you capture those for the purposes of funding the urban growth. That's again an important area. So these are the three broad areas that this center will pursue. And try and bring about implementable outcomes which are really available and which can be taken up in terms of real implementation and not remain as pure research. The other kind of theme would be perhaps over the years is the interstate comparisons, because I think the center should really address issues across the nation. And there are wide variations amongst states. The way they do plans, the way they do their regulation, the way they implement and fund their city development. So I think developing a better understanding of what those variations are and what are the learnings for across the states, that could be a theme which will be underlined and pursued at the next step towards the work of this center. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me here. It's always a pleasure to come back to Ahmedabad. I've been coming here since, if I remember well, the first time was in 1982. And it's, you know, so I can see the city evolve. And I'm always very pleased to see a lot of progress and, you know, in the way the, not only has the city developed, you know, Gujarat is well known for its economic dynamism, and you would expect that. But the way the city developed and is able to manage this growth, you know, to manage this economic development so that it doesn't result into a big mess, you know, which could happen sometimes. So here, I'm going to speak about only a very subset from the research program that Mr. Patak just described now. I'm going to talk about land affordability and the way urban market and also top-down planning interface together in order to create this affordability. I think that the duty of planner in a large city are difficult, complicated, but they can be summarized in a way in two elements. They have to make sure that there is enough mobility as a city grows. People are able to move from one part of a city to another within less than 1 hour. So they have to ensure mobility, and they have to ensure that the lowest income people and the lowest also income business are able to afford land practically anywhere in the city. These are the two elements. You know, I don't believe very much in slogan like sustainability or things like that, which are very vague and cannot be measured. I have nothing against sustainability, but I don't think that, or let's say smart goals, for instance. I'm not saying smart cities, I'm saying smart goals. Smart goals, for instance, is a slogan. Unless you measure something, there is no point talking about it. Yeah. So mobility, affordability is something you can measure. The measure of mobility is that you should be able to go from one part of the city to another in less than 1 hour, even if the city is very large. It's not the job of the planner to change the shape of the city. It's the job of the planner to adapt the transport system to the shape of the city. Too often, planners are much too ambitious and they say, well, it would be so much simpler if everybody was living there at this density. This is not the way things work at that time. So, let us start. The spatial structure of city, it's a mix of top-down design and what I would call a spontaneous order, which is created by market. Markets are a mechanism. It is not a religion, it is not a dogma, it's just a mechanism. I sometimes compare it to gravity. Whether you like gravity or not, it exists. And if you ignore it, you usually fall down and break your leg. So markets are like that. And by the way, I have worked in country where market officially didn't exist, like for instance China in the 80s, or Russia also in Eastern Europe in the 80s and beginning of the 90s. And you could see that even in those countries we did not recognize market, you could not sell land or apartment or housing openly in the market. The market was still there. It's, people recognize that some area of the city are more value than another. And so this market is there, we have to recognize it. What is important is to know that on one hand, the planner has to create an infrastructure, which is a top-down design. You know, the market cannot create a metropolitan infrastructure. It has to be designed. That means somebody has to decide this is the ring road, and they have to decide where is this ring road. And they will try to do it as, let's say, scientifically as possible, but let us have no illusion. It is relatively arbitrary. There is no scientific way to say a ring road should be 80 meters wide and it should be at 6 kilometers from the center. It's not true. It's a judgment. It has to be informed. But it's not completely scientific, but it has to be done. You see, for instance, in Ahmedabad, the TP scheme are defined by an overall plan which establishes a grid. And this grid will allow this mobility. Without this grid, there will be no mobility. So the grid has a certain dimension. The roads and the grid have a width, and there is this dimension has been selected. This is top-down design. It's absolutely necessary. You could argue that the block should be a little larger, a little longer, that maybe the width of the street should be. The important thing is to do it. Because again, there is no concrete scientific thing to do. The important thing is to know where this design is going to start and where the market is going to take over. That means the decision will not be anymore top-down, but it will be emerging from the consumption needs of households and firms. There is a tendency from planners to try, because they legitimately design the infrastructure, to try to go down and design as much as possible. I think that it's very important to know where this should start. So for instance here, I'm showing an example of top-down design. This is Paris metropolitan area. It represents an area of about 10 million people. The center of Paris is here. The Paris that tourists visit is here. People forget that Paris is at all this area, the suburbs are very important. Now, here I'm showing in red here the network of suburban train, which feed the center of Paris. Now, this has to be designed. The market is not going to provide a network like that. Whether this was the right way to put a train, a line here, we don't quite know. Probably there was a reason to do that. It was maybe already a right of way, already a road. But it has to be done. And that again is a legitimate call of action. Now, here is something that many of you will recognize. This is a plan that Corbusier did for the center of Paris. For those who know Paris, it is, this is the Louvre here. You know, the Louvre Museum is here. So, now here, this is what I call the aberration. Here is a planner. Instead of this, you know, make sure that people can move around the city in less than 1 hour, you know, get to work. He decided that he's so good at planning that he will decide where the people will live, at what density, what was the size of each apartment, and even the height under ceilings of the apartments, which, by the way, here were relatively low because Corbusier decided that the French people have a tendency to import, you know, to bring the furniture of their grandparents, and being a modernist, he hated those old furniture. So he decided that the planner had even to decide what is the height of the ceiling and to put so low that the old furniture of the grandmother who came from the farm could not fit in it. So I'm, you know, just to tell you, this is a caricature, of course, but, and it's funny, but in fact, a lot of planners do that. They decide, you know, if you look at the, you know, all the norms, which, you know, the regulation norms, you see that there are incredible details sometimes. Now, the good thing about those norms, that they are not enforced. You know, that's the saving grace of the norms. But in general, now, does that have consequence? Yes, of course, especially when you come to the lowest income group. If you define in the minute details how much land and floor space they will consume, because you think this is the best thing, the way Corbyn did it here, many of them will not be able to afford it. Or it will not be, you know, if you define the within a low-income residential area, if you define in advance the amount of street and the amount of floor space, this might not be the way poor people will want to allocate their money. You know, they may, usually you will find that they would prefer to have a little more floor space, a little less street space. So you cannot decide, at a certain time, the planner has to stop planning. And this is, let's say, the theme of my talk. Here is, this is downtown Hanoi. And for me, this is an illustration of what I mean by market. Fortunately, the Vietnamese government, although being normally very strict on regulation, you know, it's still a communist country, and you know, to a certain form using central planning, they have been very relaxed about the way the Hanoi developed. Here in the center of Hanoi, this is close to the CBD. You have very small lots, they are about 4 meter wide, and it's very active in terms of commerce. Now, you see here a building which is as a 4.5 meter frontage. It's about 25 meter long, and it has developed up to 7 floor. Now, most regulation will prevent that. They will say, this is terrible, this is inefficient, because you have a narrow building and probably the staircase, although the staircase is very steep, will take a lot of space, and there is probably a tiny little elevator in the back. So it's not very efficient. Now, if something exists like that, instead of saying it should be, this person should never have been allowed to do that, you have to ask yourself, why did they do that? And you have to assume they have invested their own money there. They know a lot of things that we don't know, that even the Vietnamese planner do not know. Here you have a shop on 3 levels, and above that, you have probably 1 or 2 offices and a residence on the top. Why would they do that? Why did they acquire 2 more plots on the side and have a bigger building with only 1 elevator, 1 staircase, which would have been more efficient in terms of end use? Why? Because acquiring the other building will take a lot of time, maybe even not possible. Maybe the person next door do not want to sell. So should this person then abstain from developing land here because of that, you know, saying, well, I wait for my neighbor to die and maybe his inheritor will not. So no, they immediately make a maximum use of the land, and they use the land very efficiently, and their decision to, you know, have a staircase for only two room on every floor is their decision, it's their money, and they have a good reason to do it, and we do not have the information to prevent it from doing that. Does it create what economists call a negative externality? You know, does it create really some terrible problem for the neighbor? Hanoi is in a tropical country where the sun is nearly vertical a lot of the time. So the idea that the shadow that, might create an externality is, you know, this is not the London of Dickens, you know. So it doesn't really create an externality. So it should be allowed to do that. What is important is that, again, the planners know where to stop here, where to stop regulating. So there is a level, at a neighborhood level, the standard should reflect consumer preference. Now, when we are dealing with middle-class people, or for instance, like the redevelopment of the CBD of Ahmedabad, where I saw it at Alda this afternoon, consumer preference of business, so they are not really limited by a very tight budget, business and a budget, I would say. But say, so you can in a way redesign a center in a certain way. When you deal with very low income people, people who are at the bottom of the income scale, but even I would say the 30% poor people, you cannot take a decision for them. And very often you affect affordability, you prevent them from having an affordable house because you plan too much. You plan, you know, the amount for road, the number of floor, everything, and it results in something unaffordable. I will give an example here of a neighborhood in Istanbul, which was originally a spontaneous neighborhood. You can see that the building, the houses are aligned, but not really. You know, you see, you know, it's a bit like a gamtal. You know, it's a Turkish version of a gamtal. And originally, that's what it was. This neighborhood has been allowed to grow. Originally, they were just one level houses, but the government had recognized its value and had left the people do whatever they needed there. As asphalted, as you can see, all roads are asphalted, but they didn't try to realign everything. This is what it looks like on the ground. You know, that again, originally was a gamtal, you know, a Turkish, you know, they were one floor, two floor. Some houses were probably, you know, not very well built, but eventually, if you leave it like that, it's what I want to concentrate on now is again this minimum housing construction. If regulation imposes a minimum construction, for instance, most regulations in the world are saying there is a minimum plot size. Minimum plot size is 80 square meter. No street should be less than 8 meter or 12 meter. You should have a parking, you know, for every house or every two houses or something like that. So here you impose a consumption on the end user. Now, if you are dealing with middle class people, usually they will consume by themselves more than the minimum, so it doesn't matter very much. But if you are dealing with very poor people, you know, people who are maybe migrants, who come from the countryside, who have a relatively, when they join the city, low productivity, they may not be able to afford that. So what happened there? I will explain here briefly on a simple graph. When, you know, in India there is a tendency to divide the population, the income by population, also into several groups, you know, EWS, LIG, MIG, HIG. this originally was probably a good idea, although the problem is that the interval here will have to change every year. What is a low-income person in Ahmedabad is not the same thing as a low-income person in Bihar. And so this category are not very useful. What is needed really for each city is to build an income distribution curve, you know. So here, horizontally, you will have the incomes, you know. So the poorer people will be here, for instance, and at the end you have zero income, and here you will have higher income. And then to calculate in each tranche of income, how many households are there, and then you end up with a curve like that, which rather than having, you know, LIG and EWS, you have a complete profile of the city. And by the way, from year to year, this curve will change, you know, in a very economically successful city like Ahmedabad, this curve is going to move to the right. You know, the bank here is going to move to the right. And so you can adjust like that. Now, so above that, I have another curve. And horizontally, I have exactly the same scale of income, but vertically, instead of representing the number of households, I represent, for instance, the amount of floor space that the people can afford at a certain income. And that, of course, is a simplification within. So, you know, for instance, if I take somebody at the income D here, and I look at this curve, and I can see how much floor space or land they consume. You know, it depends on their income. You see my curve here start with zero because this is what the market produces. If you have a zero income, you have a zero consumption. You know, this is not a market failure. That's the way this mechanism works. You know, the market has no morality. It's if you have zero income. So that would be people who are here are living on the sidewalk. You know, and so the important thing is to know for planners what the market is providing if you don't touch it. You may decide as a policy that the consumption of the lowest income people, you know, what they can afford on the market is just too low, and you will want to help them to consume more. This is completely legitimate. But, so I move to the next group. Let's say that you say, we would like a minimum, let's say we are talking about floor space. We would like that every household in our city of Ahmedabad has at least 30 square meter of floor space. You know, apartment. That would be the minimum. I say that arbitrarily. So you draw your line here of 30, and it intersects, you know, this consumption curve that the market is giving, and you draw the line down. And this area in yellow here represents the number of people who cannot afford your minimum standard. Therefore, if you are a serious government, not only a regulator, you are a serious government, you are saying, well, this is a minimum standard, and within 10 years, we are going to either build housing or to give an income of those people so they can consume this. If you do not have the money to do that, if it's just a wish, say, I wish everybody had 40 square meter, but you don't have the money to do this within 5 years, let's say maximum 10 years, this is a very dirty trick you are playing on the poor. Because you are saying, those people now are illegal. They are outside the city. I will not provide water for them. I will not provide access to work for them because they are not allowed to do that. You know, it's a bit like if you realize that in your city you have some people who do not have enough money to buy enough food, that you put a regulation saying, in this city everybody should have at least 2,000 calories a day. Now, this regulation is not going to give food to people in the same way as establishing a minimum standard here is not going to increase the size of housing for the poor. You are going to make their lives more difficult. Now, when government minimum standards, and you have a number of poor people who cannot afford those minimum standards, then the government say, market failure. It's not a market failure. It's a government failure, well, as established. So they say, well, because the market do not provide those 40 square meters to everybody, we are going to build it ourselves. This is what they built. Now, here is an example of New York, which has just been finished about a month ago, inaugurated by the mayor. Now, this is a unit in Harlem, in the northern Manhattan, you know, the building. It's one of the ugliest buildings I've ever seen. It was designed, by the way, by a very well-known architect from London. You know, the design was selected by a committee appointed by the mayor, usually people who were probably millionaire, and they were very attracted by this innovative design. You will see that in design, it's relatively similar to the EWS housing that, you know, that I made about this building. Now, when I see in this case, you know, this project was finished just 2 months ago, and the mayor came, our new mayor, Mayor de Blasio of New York, came and cut the ribbon. Now, when I see a mayor cutting a ribbon for low-income housing, I know this is not serious. You know, because there's so much need in New York for low-income housing. If the mayor was cutting a ribbon every time you know, a low-income house is produced, this would be a full-time job, just cutting the ribbon, and you would have probably to do it at night too. So when the mayor comes and cuts the ribbon, he says, look, I have produced, I think here it's 150 units, I have produced 650 units, you New Yorkers should be happy, this is it. You know, the other will be enough. Here, the report of Ahmedabad in low-cost housing is a little better than New York, but I think that here again, you know, we have a top-down design. The amount of space which is provided compared to the floor space has been decided, you know, by the top, and I don't think it's optimum. I think people would have been better off if it has been selected. So I will give now an example where. Let's say the planning stop at a certain level, and the market has been able to provide low-cost housing with some assistance of the government, but the assistance has not been in deciding on the standard, but providing services. So I will have three examples here. The kampung of Surabaya. Surabaya is the second largest city in Indonesia, and kampung in Indonesian means village. So in fact, those kampung are Gantar, which has been absorbed by the city. And because Java is, you know, it's on the island of Java, Java is extremely dense. So that means when a city expands, they are, you know, the area of Gantar, of the village that are included, are actually much larger than they are in Gujarat. So, you know, the proportion in export. Now, I will also show an example in Hanoi, where also when Hanoi expanded in Vietnam, it absorbs these villages, but it does it on purpose. And it allows those villages to develop according to their own goals. And then finally, I will have an example in Shenzhen. Shenzhen, you know, it's a new city which was built at the border with Hong Kong. It was decided, again, a top-down design, you know, the decision to create Shenzhen by Deng Xiaoping. And he decided that within Shenzhen there would be more market rules, and the government will not intervene as much. And you will see then that the way villagers, you know, again, there were some villages, the way villagers, you know, adjusted their norm, even redeveloped their own village in order to respond to the demand. Without any, you know, it's funny to think that in China, without any interference for the government. You know, in China, the government interfere a lot. Even the government will tell you how many children you can have and at what time you can have those children. But in this case, in Shenzhen, They didn't interfere about the width of street and how high the building was. So these are three examples, successful examples. Now, after that, I don't want to be all gung-ho saying anything the market does is wonderful, why don't we? There are conditions. It doesn't work always. And I will give you a terrible example of, you know, the market working, but because the government didn't provide its own input in infrastructure, the result of just market without government design, you know, at a certain level, is the outcome is terrible. So let's just look at the compound. This is the zoning plan of Surabaya. And so this is a compound. Basically, it was a village, Surabaya grew. And then the government has designed those main streets here. And along those main streets, immediately, of course, you know, the purple area here are commercial area. And along those streets, you know, you have commercial area. But the government left the compound. This could have been Islam, because there are other poor people. Some lots are very small, you know, some are no more than 10 square meters. You know, some are very flimsy houses, you know, they are in wood, with a corrugated iron. Others are relatively better quality. So most of the streets here, we will see the detail, are, you know, 2, 3, 4 meters wide, rarely more than 5, very rare. In my opinion, this compound here is already a little too large. It would have been better if here you had a larger street, you know, you have a certain size, because you still need to have emergency transport and things like that. But it has been respected, and this is and here I compare the land use, you know, in a compound. This is a measured drawing of the land use in a compound, and this is a very close to it, actually, a former, you know, development for middle-class housing. So here you have a normal, let's say, you know, grid of street blocks, and this is perfect for the middle class because they can have, you know, they can afford much more than the people. Here, if you look at this, what is interesting here is that you have some relatively large houses, which are not very dissimilar for the middle class, but you have also, in the middle of the block, some very small ones. This allows people to, in fact, consume the amount of land and floor space they can afford. What does the government do here? First, the government says, this is completely legal. You know, as soon as this is a compound, you do whatever you want. What they provide here is storm drainage. You know, most of Indonesia, you know, it's very heavy monsoon, it's swampy, so life could be miserable here if there was no storm drainage. You know, sometimes you would have 1 meter of water. That's terrible. That's the role of the government. No private sector can drain, because if you drain this area, of course, it has to be connected to the general drainage system. You cannot just drain the monsoon. So the government provides that. The government also helped them asphalt the road here, and that's where also the internal drainage is. But it never say every house here has to be accessible by 5 meter or something like that. So here, why do you have that? You see here, originally it was a village. That means every house has probably a little garden around it. Why this garden disappeared? Because being in the center of Surabaya, the people who live there decided that they had rather have more floor space and less roads. You know, most of them have no car, they have bicycle and motorcycle. Providing they can bring in a motorcycle, that's all they are interested in. You know, they make their own trade-off. And no regulator can tell that. What a regulator should do is to say, at a certain point, a neighborhood like that should be connected to a main road, to a main drainage system, to, you know. And what the government did too, you know, in a way, those kampong are run like a condominium. You know, like, you know, inside it. They are administered by the village itself. And they decide, you see here, for instance, this is a street. It's about, it's 2.50 meters wide. It's paved. The garbage is removed. Now, how is the garbage removed here? Because obviously, you cannot have a truck. Well, they have a system of running where somebody from the community has a tricycle and collect the garbage from the neighbors here and dump it in another area, which is well protected, which is enclosed. This area is brought to the main street, also completely coherent system, and then the municipality collect it. You know, again, it's a bit like if you have a middle-income condominium somewhere, you know, the garbage truck doesn't come on every floor to collect it. You have a system within the condominium to collect the garbage from each apartment, and it is deposited somewhere where the city will collect it. So here it's an horizontal condominium, but it's self-administered, and it worked very well because, again, it has the support of the government. If this area was illegal, you would not have this type of thing. This is from how you see the mix. You know, you have some houses which are kind of middle class, and some are very, very poor. But you see, here, this is certainly a very poor house. You know, somebody is very poor living there. But the fact that they have clean water supply, they have if they have a toilet, it's connected to a sewer system. This area is never flooded. They have also, by the way, a school nearby. They have a health system. They are, all this is entirely legal, make their life much more comfortable. This is the entrance. You know, every compound has a name and an entrance. And you see that's the entrance, one of the main entrances. Again, run by a condominium, by the community, connected to the network. This is inside one of those compounds. This is designed and done by the neighbor, by the way. It was something they decided to do. It was a little wider here. Look, this is at night, so you see a very narrow street. It's probably about 2 meters, but the municipality provided lighting. This is the role of the government. The role of the government is not to tell this guy, you know, you should have a kitchen of 8 square meters and a bathroom and thing. The role of the government is to provide lighting, to pave this, rent it. This is a way to support low-income housing. This is a different example in Hanoi. You had a village, and then the city is growing. So the value of this village start, you know, the value of the land start being much higher. And the villagers are allowed to build whatever they want on it, providing the neighbors do not, you know, do not object. It has nothing to do with land use regulation in the city. And what happened is that the farmer usually keep one or two floors and is renting the other floor. So here you have a very different from the kampong in the sense that it's still a village originally, but the provision of housing is different. Instead of being, you know, a very small house, you know, with corrugated iron in the middle, it is another solution. Now, income in Vietnam are a little higher, you know, especially in Hanoi, are higher than Surabaya in this sector, but that's the way it works. And of course, sorry, whatever they built here and what the land is by definition completely adapted to demand. And you have some people rent an entire floor, some rent only one room, some rent one room and there are three workers, you know, with a duck bed there living there. You have what is the advantage of that? Is that again, because this is legal, they will have a clean water supply, they will have a mix of income in the same, you know, some people will have, there will be a school there, the kids, from, if there are kids in the one, you know, the family who rent only one room, the kids will go to the same school as the farmers who own two floors. So there are a lot of advantages in having this tolerance in consumption, you know, recognizing that if people consume very little land and floor space, it's not because they are criminal or because they don't want to spend money, it's because they are obliged to. Because anybody who has more money try to consume more, so you don't have to worry about that. This is you know, what the planners in Hanoi are doing. This is an image which was taken in 2002 Google Earth, and I'm surrounded in a blue line, the contour of an existing village. You see that compared to Uganda, this is much larger, you know, as a city expands. You see here the beginning of the main infrastructure, you know, that will be the equivalent of, you know, in your master plan here for the TP scheme, you know, the big grid. And the government, you know, starts getting the right of way here. They avoid very carefully to go through one of those. You know, they consider that this is precious. They don't want to demolish this unless it's absolutely necessary. They normally they avoid. This is, you know, 6 years later, you still have this. You have a formal development here, you know, very luxurious, you know, just next to it. You have an infrastructure here which will provide transport for the entire metropolitan area. That means that if somebody is in this village, and usually in Hanoi, everybody uses motorcycle. So if you are in this village and you look for a job, you go immediately on one of those roads, and within, you know, 15 minutes, you can get your job. By the way, Hanoi is the city I have seen which is the most performing. The average commuting time in Hanoi is 18 minutes, and it's a city of 4 million people. I think this is a record, and it is due to this extreme flexibility. You know, the fact that everybody uses motorcycle, even grandmother uses a motorcycle, and you know, there is no now. I'm not saying motorcycle is necessarily good. It's a little dangerous, especially because roads are not designed for it. Although it's 85% of the transport, and you know, it's not always comfortable. It can be dangerous. But and if they are not electric, they can pollute and make a lot of noise. So what I'm saying is that if you look at the advantage of being able to, you know, if you are poor, being able to select your job anywhere in the city of Hanoi because you can get there in 15 minutes, this is a very, very big advantage. This is an income distribution curve of Hanoi, and here I have put the different type of housing, you know, the housing typology. So the lowest one is temporary housing. These are the closest thing to a slum that you find in Hanoi. These are houses which are built by contractor when they have a large building site. They build those houses for their workers. So normally, you don't pay too much attention because that's temporary, it's just for the building site. Sometimes those houses stay there. And that's really the closest thing to a slum. But you see, this represents only a tiny part here. Most of the poor people live here, you know, that's the income here, so that's really the bottom of the income. And they live in those villages. So the life might not be always comfortable, but not so bad. They have access to clean water supply and schools. What is important is that those people are poor, but because they live in those conditions, they have a better chance to move up the income scale and to find better housing eventually. This is a function of this. Now we are moving to some other example, quite different. This is Shenzhen, and this is the center of Shenzhen. You see, this is all the government buildings are here. This is the very center. Now, you notice here, these are normal apartments. It looks a bit like the apartment you have here, a five-story building, you know. And suddenly here you see something very different. And I will show you what that. This was a village before, relatively similar to the village that you see in Hanoi. But the farmers, decided together, it was not a developer, it was a farmer, that they had rather develop it their own way. And again here, the farmer were allowed to use whatever standard they wanted. And this is what is built. Those are usually 4 or 5 story buildings. The Chinese call it handshake building, because across the street you can shake the hand of your neighbors through the window. And so many of my colleagues are horrified when they say that. Again here, you know, we are in Shenzhen, which is under the tropic. The sun is vertical, the long part of the world. So having a very shadowy lane here in itself is not a problem. No, this is not Dickens London. This is a choice. That's the people who did. You know, they make a trade-off, which is shocking for us, because they say, oh my God, we could never bring our car here. If I want a taxi, we would never come here. And those people are not going to work with a taxi. So they decided that the location, if you notice, this is the center of town. From this area, those people, you raise a metro here, another metro here, they have access to millions of jobs within 1 hour. And for them, to have the maximum number of people who can live there is a big advantage. So you see, this is a little shocking, I know, but I think this is a good example. Now, I have seen something relatively similar in Hong Kong, some 25, 30 years ago. Those have all disappeared now, not because the government demolished them, but because there were no more demand for it. You know, as the income grew, increased, first you will see that some here are complete apartments, some are rooms which are rented. It's possible that there is no client for the rooms anymore. Nobody wants to live in a room with the shared bathroom. So those will be consolidated. Eventually, somebody will say, gee, this is too narrow, I would rather live in a street with trees in it. They will move out. When there is no demand for it anymore, they will do exactly the same thing that they did, you know, the farmers, because they are still, owning, in China, they don't own the land, but they own the right to use the land, which is about the same thing. And so they will redevelop it, probably into a formal, development. You don't have to worry about it. But it should be done only when there is no more demand for it, rather than say, well, those people, we want to be nice to them, so we are going to recover all this land and put them in a suburb about 30 kilometers from here because the land will be cheaper. This is the inside. You see this one of the street. And some streets are commercial, and although they are extremely narrow, you can see that there are still a lot of activity there. You know, if you can find some pretty good restaurants here, by the way. So this is a broad approach. Now, so far, I seem to be very, very enthusiastic about anything which is spontaneous and the consumer can do no wrong. Well, I'm going to show you a wrong example. This is Cairo. This is the oldest part of the city. This is the Nile here, and the Nile Delta starts right here. It's not represented on this map, but this is an agricultural here and here, and the rest is desert, outside the Nile. The Nile is right, a wide river, let's say, is cultivated only about 1 or 2 kilometers on both sides of the Nile, and the rest is pure desert, just sand and rock. As the city expands, the center, Tahrir Square is about here. That's the center of the city. Everybody knows now Tahrir Square. So the government decided that all this area here, which is next to the agricultural area, should not be developed. because it's agricultural, it should stay agricultural. And therefore they say, land is very cheap in the desert, so we are going to develop land in the desert. And these are new cities that the government built. You see the scale here, from here to here, it's about 10 kilometers. So the government decided to build those new cities with very high standard, because you know they said these are new cities, the prestige of the government and all that. They sold land relatively easily because in Egypt, if you have money, it's not very easy to invest safely in the bank accounts and all that. You cannot buy stock very easily. So people think that buying a plot of land in the desert developed by the government, whose water supply is a good investment. Although very few people want to live there, but it's a bit like buying gold or something. On the other hand, if you are poor, being in this area here, which is illegally developed, is very nice because you are within 5 or 6 kilometers from Tahrir Square. So the government says it's illegal. So this is what happened, you see. This is a former farm, and the farmers are not allowed to sell, but as we said before, the land market is there. Although the government say nobody should build here, therefore the price of land should be only the price of agricultural land, they grow vegetable or sugar cane here, that should be the price of the land. Obviously, you are here within 6 kilometers of Tahrir Square, the land has a value, whether the government like it or not, whether the government designed this as being or not. So you see here, farmers are selling their land little by little to people who feel that this is a good way. Now, the government has built, this is a ring road. This is a ring road built by the government. You know that they have an exchange here. This is a radial. This radial and this ring road doesn't give any access to those people here, because this is illegal, and the government wants to punish them or discourage them from going there. And therefore, if you live here, although you are not very far from Times Square as a crow flies, it will take you still a very long time to get there. Sometimes you are flooded because this has never been drained. There is no major street practically. You see there. This is a detail. This is 500 meters. You see, this major street here is 6.5 meters. Most of the streets here are 4 meters. This is what the market provides. You see, this is a trade-off. Now, this would be okay if this was a community, and here you had a major street, and you had a school here, and you had the middle-income people here. That would be very good, I have no objection. But if on 10 kilometers you have this type of thing, this is a disaster. In terms of transport, for instance, imagine. So people here, again, circulate with motorcycle and motorcycle taxi. Most of the taxi are motorcycle. Very difficult to remove garbage from here because, again, it's illegal, so you cannot organize that as really a condominium. The government will never collect the garbage at area. This is really something that didn't succeed. Now, the people living there are not really poor. This is the type of housing they built. Again, it's multi-story apartment. This is not, again, not even a Surabaya compound. There are people with much higher income. But because it's illegal, because the government never acknowledged that there were this type of people, they never. So imagine living at this density, this are among the highest density in the world, without, the water is very. Sometimes you have a well and somebody pump the water, but the water is, as you can imagine, a terrible quality because there is no sewer. Many of them you have seepage pit and you have a well not far from it. So you see, the problem here is not so much that the people have built like that way, is that the government has not acknowledged that there was a demand for this type of housing in this location. You know, they have decided by coloring their map green that nobody would build there. And that was enough. The market was there. There was a very high price for land, and the farmers have sold this land. So this is 29 kilometers from Times Square. You see an enormous infrastructure, the government, you know, highways, roads, you have even street lamps there, absolutely nobody. But everybody has bought the plot, by the way. The government made money out of it, you know, they sold the plot. So you have a huge infrastructure, you have sewer, drainage, electricity, street lighting, but there is nobody. And here you are at 7 kilometers from Times Square. You have a lot of people, you have no water, no electricity, no drainage. So, what is the conclusion? Setting by regulation minimum housing standard is a cruel joke played on the poor. It doesn't increase, you know, to making poverty illegal, do not decrease poverty. And this is what the minimum standard is. So, we all hope that if people, you know, poor people consume very little floor space or very low quality housing, we all hope that eventually they will get better. But the first thing, if you want to help them, is to provide them with infrastructure. If you are in a country which has enough money to provide housing to all the people who are below, who cannot afford the minimum housing, then do it, but do it in 5 years. Don't do it in 100 years. If you have money for housing and you want to build housing for the very, very poor, you know, let's say the 5% poor people, you know, you may have people who are, have been very unlucky in life, maybe people who are handicapped, you know, old people who have no resources. This is completely legitimate to just build them houses and give it to them. But if the people you want to give housing to represent 50% of the population, you will never give it to them. So to pretend that you will do it and have them on a waiting list which lasts 30 years is not very serious. So the top-down design, you know, again, is completely legitimate, but it should mostly concern the metropolitan infrastructure, transport, and it should adapt to the shape of the city. Don't try to shape the city necessarily. You know, don't say, I would like a city with, to look like a star or donut or something like that. You know, this doesn't work. You know, land has a value, people recognize this value, and this is what guides development, whether you do it. Spontaneous settlement neighborhoods, which are driven by consumer preference, I think are very valuable, especially in countries where there is a huge disparity of income, you know, where you have migrants who have very low income, probably low productivity, they have to be accommodated. Those settlements should not be too large, you know, they should be not too far from a main infrastructure, so that they can be connected easily, not to the Cairo thing. My guess is that it's a rule of thumb that probably about 300 meters, you know, will be about it. But this is, again, arbitrary. If somebody thinks 400 meters, I would agree with this person, or even 800 meters. But this is arbitrary. It depends very much on a lot of things. You know, it depends on the nature of the soil, it depends on, you know, if it's flat, if it's hilly. But they should be, the important thing is that those settlements should be connected to an infrastructure network, which is metropolitan wide. It should not be just a local street. What is also very important, if you want to solve, you know, make housing more affordable, you should be sure that the supply of developable land is increasing as the population increases. Because the more you restrict, you know, the the developable land, the more the land which is developable will have a high price. What I like very much, by the way, about the plan that Paula did for the metropolitan area of Amelia is that there's a lot of area which is not yet developed there, but the infrastructure is planned there. You know, the right of way, the alignments are there, they are very clear. So whatever happened there, you imagine that maybe in some of those blocks here, even within the TP scheme, you will have some very poor people who will have something which look like Islam. At least they will be connected, they will be trained, they will not be flooded, they will be connected to the whole network if they want to get to a job. When all this network of streets is done and your transport system is done, their accessibility to job will be very important. So their income are likely to go up after some time. So this is the best way if you have some subsidy that you can give to the poor, the best is to give it to the infrastructure, within the settlement itself, and social services, schools and health. This is the role of government. To decide whether the street should be, the access street should be 2 meters, 6 meters, 10 meters, I don't think it's useful. To decide whether a kitchen should be oriented to the north or the south is not useful. Thank you.
If anybody has any questions.
Read two cities examples. I've not been to those cities. One is Stockholm and another one is Curitiba.
Yes.
In both of those places, I think anticipated metropolitan growth,
yeah.
And defined corridors along which they increased the FSI,
yes.
Which then channelized the new development along those corridors, which then had transport infrastructure,
yeah.
and eventually are studied as case studies these days. So what is your take on those two?
I know those two cities, by the way. That two different examples. Let's start with Curitiba, which is more well-known. The mayor of Curitiba was an architect. He was first an architect of the city. He became mayor. And after becoming mayor, he became governor. So you had a continuity of policy there, from the chief planner to the mayor to the governor. And he decided that transport was the major driver of the city, but he decided also on a... I can do it. He decided that the BRT was the best way of transport, which makes a lot of sense. Curitiba at the time was too poor to afford a rail subway. And he designed, can you hear me if I speak like that? I'm an architect, so I'm without the graphic part, but I'm really here. But so, Curitiba is a big block like that, and the center appeared looked like a pear. And the center is toward the north, not in the center, for some reason. Now, the mayor decided that in order to optimize this BRT, you will have a particularly linear city along it. And traditional center of creative arts. The city had a tendency to expand toward the, you know, the south. So the mayor decided to have a transport corridor here, ERT. Here was an area for higher income people in more traditional colonial buildings. And so there was also from here another access like that. And I remember where another one like that. If you decide first on a type of transport, and all your land use is designed so that your type of transport that you have selected will be optimized in its operation. Don't forget that there is a difference between the interest of the operator of the transport system and the interest of the citizen. It is not quite the same. Here, by having a long axis like that and trying to concentrate the growth along this axis, you know, here, for instance, you had a high FSI along this. Here, which was a traditional center, you know, near the traditional center, they allow the rather rich people here to sell the development right to people who had a plot of land here. So they, you know, in order, so that's why, by the way, politically there was no resistance of keeping here the FSI very low. So you could, you know, if you had a villa here with a tennis court and a swimming pool, you could still sell the development right at a market price and stay with your swimming pool and your tennis court, although you were very close to the city center. So, you know, I'm not saying it's bad in itself. What happened is that then everything grew like that. And if you look at the average distance of transport and the time of transport, it is rather high. Because you know, if you operate a system, the longer you know the line is, the better it is, because you use it in both directions, but you also increase the distance. Now, what happened here is that in this area, that's where you put the lowest income housing, because you are farther here, so you have higher density here. And so you have longer transport. You know, if you look at the density profile of Curitiba, you know, if I take the density, you know, this is distance here, and this is the density, and people per hectare. If I take Ahmedabad, you have a curve which is bad like that. You know, the density decreases for, you know, the people per hectare. I'm not saying this. In Curitiba, You have a curve which is like that. Now, what does it mean? It means that you have more people who are far away from the center who take your bus. So you are selling a lot of tickets. You are having a big return. You know, ideally, if you want to have a very efficient transport system, this is what you will do. You will build two towers, 5 kilometers from each other. You will have a DRT between the two. You will divide the tower in two. You will have residence A here, resident B here, and here you will have jobs, office building or whatever. People in B have to work here, people in A. You have the most fantastic transport system because it's used at rush hour, it's easy for the impulse. Imagine that you want to optimize your land use by minimizing the cost of the sewer system. The sewer is very expensive. You will have the sewage plant in the middle of the CBD, because that will shorten and you will have it. You will have the highest density around the sewage plant. So you know, to try to optimize a city shape by simplifying the function of the city, saying, especially if you decide on the mean of transport, it's a very dangerous thing because you simplify the system. The way people use land is very different. By the way, in the case of Curitiba, the traditional center here is losing value because now it's eccentric. You know, it's too far away from it. There's more value here, but if you look at the income of the people in Curitiba is much higher, and there's something that puzzled me is that Curitiba has not published, to my knowledge, over the last 10 years, the transport mode. We don't know how many people are using the BRT and how many people are using cars. Income has increased enormously, you know, the state of Paraná, where Curitiba is located, has been extremely successful. Curitiba did also another thing which is interesting. I'm sorry to just throw the bombs there. By the way, Curitiba did also extremely innovative things in recycling water. You know, they do a lot of things which are very positive, but you know, very innovative thing. And in a way, the invention of the BRT, was a great thing. What I reproach to them is not to have said, well, this is our land use, and whenever the city develops, we are going to, you know, the city would have been better off developing with more bus lines and shorter, rather than one very long. But this is a big advantage for the operator. So again, I don't want to minimize the contribution of Curitiba, but I think it's dangerous to select, you know. I will give you an example of that. I was working in Indonesia with the World Bank many years ago, and I was working on financing housing. So we looked at the price of land and infrastructure in Jakarta, and we decided if we want to reach the lower middle class, the density, would have to be in those projects around 300 people per hectare, something like that. I had a colleague from JICA, you know, the Japanese, was developing a light rail around Jakarta. And he wanted his light rail to work well. So he decided that along the right route, the light rail, the density would be about 1,000 people per hectare, because that's to optimize the operation of the light rail. And the light rail was only a bit like Curitiba, one line, you know, because it's much easier to build one line than to build five. And then I had another colleague who was for the World Bank, and he was an engineer designing the sewer system. And so they made a test in the land around Jakarta, and they decided that if the density kept below 50 people per hectare, there was no real need for a sewer system, that the soil was such that it could have seepage feet. And so that was an enormous saving. So he recommended that in Jakarta, the density should not be more than 50 people per hectare. So you see here, we have three different approaches because we concentrate only on one thing, and that decides the way people will build. It's a very dangerous thing to do. So that's why it's better to follow the market and try to develop a transport system which serves, you know, whatever the shape of the city is. Now, this is, sorry, my answer is a little long, but Stockholm. Now, Stockholm is different. You know, Stockholm has a very difficult, beautiful, but difficult topography. It is this water table where the center is, in fact, an island, a little island that is connected. What's interesting also is that it's one of the few Scandinavian countries where most people live in apartments, not in houses. The government had, you know, very early a habit of building apartments. You know, there's a lot of public housing or housing which is developed by the government and then sold on the market after. And indeed, they shape the city. What, you know, and they develop it, you know, they develop it around, you know, they have a light train and things like that. I'm not completely sure, you know, in a way, there was not, because of the topography, there was not many choices, you know. So in a way, what they did, you know, if you have an enormous constraint on land because of, you know, you have water bodies later everywhere, you have, in fact, a very high constraint on land. You know, if you look at, say, the center is here, if you look at the radius of 10 to 20 kilometers, instead, like Ahmedabad, on 20 kilometers, practically all the circle, except for the Sabarmati, is usable. Here in Stockholm, you have only a small part of it. So in a way, probably the market would have given about the same thing and would have explained the apartment. You know, if you have, you know, it's a natural shortage of rent, so you have it. They provided the transport, and again, because of the big lake, you know, which are long and narrow, it was a smart thing to provide the transport along those, you know, on the land. I'm not sure that they shaped the city. I think it's a topography who shaped the city. And the fact that, you know, they took the initiative, they did, the transport works very well. The city center is still the traditional city center. They did also something that I found objectionable. They have a zoning system which says that in every neighborhood, even at 25 kilometers from Stockholm, you should have a balance between jobs and housing, with the idea that if you live here, you will also work. And they still have that. So what happened is, if you have a developer, or if the government cleared the housing, they will try to find somebody who say they will provide jobs, you know, to match it. So you end up with a relatively fake industry in order to get the land. And if you look at the transport or things like that, you see that people who live here, you know, use a transit system to move here or here or here. And if there are some jobs here, the people who work there come from here. This is the experience part of the world, the whole settlement. Why? If you move to Stockholm, which is a rather expensive city, it's because you are looking for a job. You are not going to move to Stockholm and say, I'm going to move there, but I'm going to look for a job within 500 meters from my house. You know, the idea of being in Stockholm is that you have very, very specialized people. You know, the more specialized you are, the more you need to be in a large city. So you are looking for a job wherever it is, which corresponds to either the type of salary you expect, or your interest, or a mix of the two, or something like that. That you have probably a spouse, and the idea that both you and your spouse will work within 500 meters of your house is unlikely. If you change job, you are not going to change house because you have changed job. You are going to take your transport system and go there. So this idea that you can, you know, you can have a balanced, you know, neighborhood which minimizes transport is not true. You have to provide whatever transport is necessary to go from one part of the city to another. And if some people want to live within 500 meters from their job, that's fine. But that will be a minority. It's not a system. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
Maybe we take two more questions and then, or a few more questions. We can stop in 10 minutes.
Probably like 25 kilometers away from where your current network is.
Yes. And that's where we do it most intensively. So in that context, would the government keep extending services as and when these fringe areas get blocked?
Okay, that's a, yeah, that's a very good. You see, when you have a city, let's say the city is here, the center is here, you have an infrastructure which goes up to here, and then you have, let's say, villages here, right? Now, don't forget, a city is a labor market. Now, the infrastructure expands up to here, but probably from here, with a motorcycle, you can reach the city in less than an hour. So although the infrastructure expands up to here, this is part of your labor market. As soon as you have area, which, you know, I take this 1 hour as an example, it could be 1 hour and a half, depending on the people, but that means that anybody who is in this village can get into this area. Then you have a demand for it. If you, obviously, housing here will be cheaper than here because it has no infrastructure, very little. However, the advantage of living here is precisely that it's cheaper. So you make a trade-off between the distance, you know, again, if you have a scooter, the time it will take to you, the cost of your scooter, and it's quite possible that rather than living here in a formal subdivision, it will be cheaper to live here because you don't have to pay, impact fee or whatever you have. So the only, so your question is, then it take, should the infrastructure expand? Well, if you have been providing enough growth here, you know, at a cost and allow the standards to vary, instead of having relatively rigid standards, the odds are that people will prefer to get closer. If they make a trade-off, don't forget that nothing exists. You know, people are not fools. If they do that, you know, when you see something that puzzles you, you know, like this tall building in Hanoi, don't think this person is an idiot. Think they do that for a reason that I don't quite understand. And if you understand it, then the thing is, well, yes, my answer is yes, you should provide infrastructure there because, you know, in a way, the fact that there are people who live here means that you have not provided enough housing closer at the price that those people could afford. So rather than say, we didn't provide it, but one day we will, there we will make your life miserable here until we provide it, I think it's better just to. So,
in India, often we see that the government or government agencies go around acquiring lands in the
territory.
They acquire land, no?
Yes.
Using state or eminent domain. No?
Right, yeah.
So, it is often at a very low price to be converted into, let's say, an industrial or housing. So. In your experience, is it fair, or how does it work globally? Do you think the state should have a power to expropriate land, from the farmers in the periphery?
Look, when it is for the right of way of street, you have an alternative, which is a TP scheme, you know, which you don't use in any domain. But let's say in many cities, probably you have to have. The government uses eminent domain for the right of way street. One reason is that when you acquire land for the right of way street, you do not have a real market in the sense that you cannot have a street which goes like that. So you cannot say, well, you know, if you have a free market, it means that people are free to sell to you. It's their choice. If you have a street going this way, people are not free to sell, because you have no choice but to buy the land there and not here. So therefore, it's not really market. So you have to use eminent domain. I think that it's better for the government to pay as close as possible to the market price, because if they don't pay the market price, they will have a tendency to buy more land, And then we get into the problem you were mentioning. If the government buy more land because it's cheap to the government, then your city will expand much more than it would otherwise. Now, your question was for industrial estate. I think the same, that it's even more true for industrial estate. If the government acquire land below market, and either they sell it at market, and then it's not very honest. You know, they are in fact the private farmer from the income, and they put it in their pocket. You know, if the farmer has an income from selling the land, there could be a tax, so I have no problem with that. But that the government take the property of somebody and sell it at a very high price without having done much to it, I think that's not very honest. It's better to tax a person who has a capital gain. The problem also with that is that if the government acquire land at a very low price for farmer, you will have much larger industrial area that you need, probably, because again, if the land is very cheap, there is no reason not to use a lot of it. You know, that's the idea of the land. That's why you have villas, in low density in the suburb and high density, because in the suburb, land is cheaper, so you use more. So in a way, the government contributes then to a uneconomical use of land by not paying the price, inaugural price. I think that prices send a signal, to the economy, if it reflects value. Now, there are cases where in country, could be the case in India, where land is not acquired because of its potential use, but it's acquired just as a saving. A bit like the example I gave in Cairo, people buy land in the desert, this government thing, they have no intention of living there for the moment, but they consider that given the alternative, it's a good investment. It's an edge against inflation, where if they buy government bonds or something like that, probably they will lose money in the long run. So here again, the market price has to be taken with a grain of salt in the case where you have this problem. So you have to find what is the price of land based on the rent you can get from this land. For instance, if we are back to this example here, of people living in a village there, you can see if they are renting or buying, you can see what is the price there, and this is really the real price if they live there. You see, so you have to make a bit of difference to that, because indeed, sometimes there are distortions on the price of land, and you have to make the difference. But that's why it's so important for planners to understand markets. A bit long-winded answer. Any more questions?
In India, 20% tax, people will own a house for life.
Yes.
So they will not work for the entire duration of owning a house.
Yes.
And they will not very easily move into rented accommodation once they own a
right, house. Yes.
In Hanoi, when you show the owner will just use part of that.
Yes, right, yeah. Yeah, I mean, each country has its own, there is a cultural aspect in the land market, which is different, depending, for instance, say, in the United States, as your income increases, most people will want to have a bigger house, and even live farther away from the suburbs so they could afford a little bigger house. In Europe, if you can afford 200 square meter and if your income increases, people will not buy more than 200 square meter. They'd rather spend their money on traveling or having fancy clothes or something like that. So there's a cultural aspect to it. Now, in your question, I think there's a second aspect of your question, is that if people have a house, they will never sell it. You know, it's a family heirloom in a certain way. Stay in the family, they want to leave it to their. It's possible that this is a cultural thing, or maybe it's possible that because the transaction cost of selling a house and buying another one is very high, you know, there's an uncertainty, or you have to pay stamp duty or something like that. And therefore, people have a tendency to stay in the same place because it's so complicated to move. Again, here, if it's a real preference, which is deep in the culture, you have, you know, that's part of the aspect of the market. You have to take it. But maybe if it is due to transaction cost, I think then it's a bad thing because it removes mobility. You know, you end up with people, for instance, who may live in the center of town, and they are old, they don't work anymore, they are retired, and they will maybe be better off living in a suburb with a garden, you know, where there will be less noise and things like that. But they don't do it because it's complicated, or because, imagine, you know, the capital gain tax, for instance, you know, seems to be a very fair tax because, after all, if your house increases in price, it's not because of your sweat, you know. It's just like that. However, it has one enormous disadvantage, is that if your house has a certain value after 20 years, which is much higher than what you paid originally, if the government takes a tax of, say, 50% of the added value, if you buy a new house, if you sell your house and buy a new house, you are not going to buy this new house at the price of 20 years ago. You are going to. So that means that the capital gain tax obliges you to stay where you are, whether you want to move or not. You know, I have seen examples of people, you know, in the United States, you know, all people like to go to Florida. You know, they live in New York, they feel because the climate is nicer, and by the way, real estate in Florida is much, much cheaper than New York. So if you are retired, you are much better off living in Florida. However, if you are in an area where you have a high capital gain tax, on the, because sometimes the government put it and sometimes they normally for your own house they remove it. But say, sometimes they do have a capital gain tax, you're stuck. Because if you sell, you can buy a house half of the size because half of the, you know, you are in this market. So you see, you have to look at all the aspects, and that's why, you know, when they discuss the research of the center, they took this fiscal aspect into, the fiscal aspect can affect the way people use land. And what seems fair, you know, like a capital gain tax, you know, normally it seems very fair, but it has a negative effect, which maybe is not desirable, although it may create some income for the government. So, you know, you have to look at this aspect and the lack of mobility. Imagine that, you know, you could move in an area where, let's say you are a university professor, so you know that your job is going to stay in this university for a long time, for a tenure, so it is quite possible that it's your interest in the long run to get closer to your university, you have more time for yourself. But if you have a high stamp duty or capital gain tax or a high transaction cost, you'll be stuck where you are, and you are going to always commute. You have to make this decision yourself, and in a way, the fiscal system may prevent you from moving. And don't forget that if you move, there is probably somebody who is looking for a house where you are now. So you are in the wrong location, and this person want to move there, cannot move there because you don't move yourself. So you affect the person. That's why this fiscal aspect is so important. It affects land use.
One last question.
Sir, I have a more fundamental question because we are discussing a lot of markets here, and we have been talking about the top-down trade-offs, development control rights, how they can be more affordable. The fundamental question that I think the Indian space is not allowed in terms of land and land ownership.
Yes. We have varied forms in which the land delivery and land ownership mechanisms happen. So one is the eminent domain approach, approach, and whole market approach that some cities are now adopting. So, you know, in this phase of transition from eminent domain to the welfare state approach to then the market phase, what do you think, I mean, how should the cities actually start dealing with land? It's then tied up to what are the issues you really started discussing.
Right, yeah.
The development control regulation and what comes, what kind of floor space comes through the development control regulations. So, it's more of a basic question that, you know, how do we really start thinking about land in that political context?
Let's say, I think really that eminent domain should be used only for the right of way. You know, again, you can get away with it with the typical, but it could be that in some area where for some reason you can't do it, then I think it's legitimate for that. It's probably legitimate, let's say if you want to locate a sewer plant, you do not have a choice, you know, you cannot. So the sewage plants usually have to be in a certain area, you know, low area, you know, it has to be. So here you do not have a choice, you should use a domain. I don't think it's a good idea to use eminent domain for residential area or for industrial area because it's completely distort the amount of land you can go into. I think that you know, if you create a new city and use eminent domain, you know, I would use the TP scheme there for new city. You know, I think it's the best way because if you use eminent domain, you create an enormous distortion. You know, from the beginning, you are not paying. You know, you are not really paying these costs, and you will have a tendency not to use land very efficiently. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Alain Bertaud, and thank you all for coming here. We hope, just like you visited us last year and this year, we hope to see you again next year again at some point.